Ich werde dann noch einen Supervisor ins Sammeln löschen. Zum Beispiel.
Alright.
Ich bin Ivrit.
Ich bin Ivrit. Ich bin
Ivrit.
Predictions to get an even better
with a predictor.
Yeah, participant is an algorithm.
Yes, a participant is an algorithm, mm-hmm. precisely, yeah. Yeah, it's an algorithm constructed by some research group somewhere. But indeed, it's an algorithm. And I only know its prediction, I don't even know. It's like a black box algorithm for me.
What are the conditions?
The conditions are various different... the short answer is I don't know, I have to look back, but it's many different biological conditions on this...
On the image or on the like profile?
No, on the... on the cancer cell lines.
On the cell...
On the cancer cells. Okay, but we can look at the actual paper and it should have the exact details. Okay. Alright, so again, it's the same problem. We get such a matrix, we have no labeled data, and we are trying to figure out who's more accurate, who's least accurate, etc. I'll give you one last motivation before I start doing the math. This is a joint project with David Steinberg from Tel Aviv and Yael Ratzinger from Sorek Nuclear Center. It's about estimating earthquake magnitudes. So how do you estimate earthquake magnitudes? We have many stations around the world, and it's something like, so there are like maybe 50 primary stations and another 150 secondary stations, but think about M as being 50 for a minute. And the key goal is, of course, to detect nuclear events and distinguish them from natural earthquakes. And one of the important quantities is the magnitude of the event. And currently, for each detected event, each station estimates its magnitude given this, the signal, the seismic signal it had it on its own. And the reported network magnitude, there is a center in Vienna that related to the nuclear ban treaty. That's the way they do it. They just do simple averaging. And of course, machine learning should clearly understand that this is maybe terribly inaccurate, especially if some stations are biased, or some stations are more accurate or least accurate than others, or if some stations are correlated. But the problem is that I don't have ground truth. I don't know what was the... So the vast events are, of course, earthquakes. And I don't know what was their actual strength. So can I somehow detect if some stations are biased, or some stations are strongly correlated, or some stations are far more accurate than others, without any ground truth data? Okay. So this is just for motivation. This, we have some data set from this. It's far more complicated than what I'm showing you here, but all right. So that's the problem. Let's put it under a clear statistical formulation. I'm going to talk about the regression problem. So I have x, some explanatory variables, y is my response, its real value. I have m pre-constructed predictors, algorithms, and I have this matrix z, fi of xj. And I'm going to try to, my task to detect the most and least accurate regressors, construct an ensemble learner to better accurately estimate y, and I want to do all of this without any labeled data whatsoever. Okay? Seems impossible. It is impossible unless I'm going to do some assumptions. So I'll try to do some very minimal assumptions and show you how can this be done. Okay, so the assumptions. First of all, I'm going to assume that I know the mean of the response, y. And one reason is that if I get just this matrix, I can, you know, add 1 million to all entries. I need somehow to calibrate something, okay? So either I know the first moment of y, or somehow I know that the estimators are unbiased on average. That would also give me an estimate of the first moment of y. But because in several practical applications we observe that some experts are biased, this allows me to be biased.
So basically, the first moment of y is on each row or on the...
No, yeah. So let's put his ground truth, which is unknown, y1 up to yn. So the first moment of y would be the average of the y's when n goes to infinity.
That's right.
Okay? It's, in some cases, it's quite reasonable to assume that you know this single scalar. Okay, let's see. I should also mention that, at least on some of the datasets we played with, some experts were terrible experts. They were just way off. If I somehow know the variance of y, then I can also detect highly inaccurate regressors, because if a regressor is very accurate, its mean squared error must be much smaller than the variance of y. So its own variance has to be roughly the variance of y, whereas if the variance of some regressor, so if one of the rows here has a variance which is way much higher than the variance of y, it cannot be accurate. Okay? But this is not crucial. The crucial is to know just the first moment of y. Okay.
And also opposite. All his predictions are the same constant with no variance.
Yes, that is easy to detect. You see that I'm going to do a spectral method, so if one of these is almost constant, it's fine with me. Okay. Yeah.
You had also assumption that x is IID.
Yeah.
It's very strong assumption.
I'm assuming that the x is IID for my...
But it's very strong assumption that you're losing the real cases that you gave as examples.
No.
Like earthquakes.
In the earthquakes, x is an IID from the distribution of earthquakes. In the stock market, x is our stocks. And
which are not IID.
Stocks are IID. The whole world is the world of stocks.
No, I think there's a question between independence and conditional independence. You have to be more... What exactly are you assuming?
So I'm
example,
assuming that the measurements
of the earthquakes will be highly correlated because they all measure the same thing.
Wait, no. I haven't talked about correlations between the Fs. I'm just saying that the Xs are IID. The instances are IID from the marginal of
okay,
the
in stock market, this is probably not true. Stocks are highly correlated.
The value of the stock is correlated.
Yeah.
Yes.
But he's saying which stock will be measured is just a random.
Yeah, or here I just set the whole space.
Or you see the whole space, yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right.
There is a distribution, and given the distribution,
But no, the results of different X's may be highly correlated, that's fine with me, and also some X's may be highly correlated, that's fine with me as well. We'll get to that in a minute. Okay? All right. Now, I will focus, I'm trying to do something with almost both hands tied behind my back, so I'm going to try to construct an ensemble learner, which is the simplest thing possible, a linear ensemble learner, and just try to find weights that minimize my mean squared error, okay? Now, what are two key quantities when you try to construct a linear ensemble learner? One is the covariance matrix of the regressors. And the other one is the covariance with the response. And you can easily prove that, think about a supervised case, or even an Oracle case, you know everything, and you just want to find what are the optimal weights, so you just take the derivative of these squares, and the optimal predictor, the optimal weights, just satisfy this equation. Okay? So C is the covariance of the regressors, rho, let me write it here for a minute. So CI, I already mean-centered my data, and so CIJ is the average of FI, FJ over X's, and rho I is the average over X and Y of FI of X, Y of X. So, in an unsupervised setting, I only have this matrix, think about n as being huge, I can easily estimate these values. So the key challenge is somehow to estimate this, which involves the response y, but without any labeled data whatsoever. Okay? So, the question is, can we do it somehow? Let me give you some motivation. So, here I'm talking about unsupervised regression, but there's been a lot of work on unsupervised ensemble classification. One by now very popular model is a model that is now called the Widen-Skin model. For classification, they assumed that each expert has its own accuracy, but different experts make, it's called the conditional independence model, they make conditionally independent errors given the value of y. So this has become a highly popular model, mainly in crowdsourcing. If you assume this, you can write an explicit likelihood for this matrix. It's not convex, it's typically solved by EM, but in recent years, the different people have developed spectral and tensor-based methods to estimate the parameters. We did some work on this a few years ago, in which we looked at the covariance matrix of the classifiers. So in the case of classification, binary classification, this is just a matrix of plus ones and minus ones. And the important thing is that we found out that this matrix had a very simple structure in classification. It had, its diagonal was approximately rank 1, or was exactly rank, its off diagonal was exactly rank 1, and the eigenvector was proportional to the balanced accuracies of the classifiers. So, in the classification case, a single assumption allowed to solve the problem and reveal the very interesting structure, and you can ask, moving from classification to regression, is there some analog that would have a similar flavor? Okay. All right. In terms of regression, in the unsupervised case, there were relatively very few works. There was work by Don Mez and Guy Lebanon a few years ago, but they assumed some parametric models. There's another recent work. It's also parametric, they just assume that each expert, so this paper essentially assumes that fi of x is just y plus Gaussian error, okay, maybe it's sigma I, so each expert has its own variance. There was a recent paper by Wu et al., which is based on, essentially, after two steps, it's actually based on the spectral approach I told you before. And they propose some spectral approach, but they just write that they don't have any mathematical justification for it. It's just an empirical work. There's been a lot of work on supervised ensemble regression. In general, combining classifiers or combining experts is a good thing. There's a famous work by Boosting. There have been many works on stacking. The key point about these two different lines of work is that they retrain the classifier, okay? And that's something that I cannot do. My experts are black boxes. I don't even know how they operate. I cannot retrain them. So these methods are not suitable in my setting, at least. Even though I'm not talking about neural networks, I have two slides with neural networks, okay? So first of all, some people may have been born after this paper, maybe, but back neural networks were here in the 80s and in the 60s, and in 1992, there was this paper by Peroni and Cooper, and it was about how to merge the predictions of different neural networks. At the time, they were probably like two layers deep or something. But they developed various methods how to combine the predictions of neural networks, among others, for example, assuming such a model. And this paper was published in Machine Learning a few years later. They propose a supervised spectral approach. Let me tell you a little bit about this work. So remember that the optimal weights satisfy this equation, Cw star equals rho, C is the covariance between the regressors. Now, this matrix may be highly ill-posed because, you know, different regressors may be quite strongly correlated. and trying to invert it.
Ill condition, not ill condition.
Yeah, ill condition, sorry. Yeah, ill condition, sorry. And trying to invert it, maybe, yeah, it's a positive condition. And trying to invert it in positive condition. And trying to invert it may be quite an unstable operation. What Merz and Pazani proposed was let's take our label data, it's a supervised scheme, let's compute the sample covariance from the label data, let's compute its leading eigenvectors, or principal components, and let's try to find a weight vector W, which is just a linear combination of the top capital K principal components, and we'll find the coefficients by least squares because it's a supervised method. And so this overcomes this issue of ill conditioning of the metric C, you never invert it. And they propose to choose K by cross validation. When we found out about this paper, we implemented it, and you know, in a supervised game, it works pretty well in practice, and typically K is just one. Turns out that almost always you just take the first principal component. And that's enough. But there is no rigorous theoretical understanding why.
Okay. So in that case, W is just equal to the
some constant times the leading eigenvector. Okay? But there's no explanation. Actually, so this does not appear in their paper. I'm telling you, you have to trust me. I'll explain to you why in a minute. Okay? Even though
and if K equals one, you don't need the supervision because
no.
You only have to.
No, for beta, to estimate the coefficient.
It's all, yeah.
Yeah, but it's crucial.
You can solve it up to a constant.
Yes, up to a constant. So I'll show you why something actually need K equals 2. Mm-hmm. I mean, as a typically. Okay? I want to give you some very, under some assumptions, some very rigorous theoretical explanation of what's going on. Why, to begin with, projecting to principal components is a good idea. Okay, so up to now, it was all previous work. And now I'm going to show you what we have done. So I'm going to have, other than knowing the average of y, I'm going to make a single model assumption. You should shout at me if you think it's not realistic. Okay? And then I'll tell you, great, let's continue working on it. I'll show you that if you take this single model assumption per se, you assume it's perfectly correct. I'll just show you how to solve everything with just linear algebra. It will turn out to be a spectral approach, and it will allow us to estimate the optimal mean squared error, to rank the regressors by the mean squared error, to estimate the optimal weights. I'll explain you, it will also explain why. So GEM was, GEM, the method by Corona and Cooper in the context of neural networks was just, I mean, they had many different methods, but one of them was just omega hat equals C inverse rho. That was one of their methods, okay? And they called this method the generalized ensemble, general ensemble method. So I'll explain to you why indeed this matrix is ill-conditioned, and why typically you get K equals 1 or 2. Okay. All right. So, first of all, suppose I was an oracle and knew the full joint distribution of x and y, and I wanted to estimate y for a new x and minimize my mean squared error. The optimal thing that I can do is the conditional mean, and its optimal mean squared error is just the variance of y minus the average of this quantity g of x squared. So I can now write each of my regressor as g of x plus some deviation from this optimal regressor. And the assumption I'm going to make is that each of the black boxes that try to estimate the response, they really tried to do a good job. And each of them tried to estimate g as best as possible. And the assumption I'm going to make, and this you can think about it as somewhat of an analog of the Dawidian scheme model, I'm going to assume that when you average across all the x's, different experts make uncorrelated errors, but with respect to the optimal g. Okay? So different experts are strongly correlated. They both try to predict y. But once I remove the common, if you think, like a latent common factor, they make uncorrelated errors on average. Okay? This is the assumption I'm going to make.
So by one, you mean something like square difference from G is bounded or something like that? Well, it's fairly close.
Excellent question. So, if you assume this exactly, I don't really need this. I'll need this in a minute. So, I'm going to assume that the average of hi squared is much, much smaller than the variance of y. But if you take this exactly, I don't really need one, and you'll see that in a minute. Okay. All right. So. Okay. So. Let's assume this holds exactly, and then we get the following theorem.
The difficult part about this assumption is that it's all additive, right? If instead of addition of hi of x there, it would be multiplied by...
Why would it be reasonable to assume to write f as g times h? First I would then take a log. No, but you know, I have a regression problem. I had some labeled data, and trying to predict
why. Yes, assuming that the noise is additive, I think this is...
It's not the noise, this is a deviation of my regressor.
I can always
write f as g plus h. The question is, what do I assume about the relation between errors of different... H is the deviation from the optimal regression function, and so you can think about it as your error. So this is an assumption about errors being uncorrelated between different regressors. I didn't assume anything about a specific black box.
So okay. You mean your experts came from different schools?
Hopefully, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because
yeah.
Use their...
Yeah, they use different design principles. They, one is an SVM, one is a nearest neighbor regressor. Yeah. I'll show you later on how you can actually test this assumption without any label data as well. Okay, I forget. Okay. All right. So, let's assume that this assumption holds for a minute. I'm claiming that under this assumption, I can solve everything just by linear algebra. And here is the theorem. So, let's assume for a minute that I also know the error of the optimal regressor, or like equivalently know this quantity G2, then the claim is that if I have at least three regressors that they make uncorrelated errors, I can consistently estimate rho. Remember, I don't have any y, but I can still consistently estimate rho just by linear algebra, and actually even with error which scales like 1 over square root, this would be the parametric error rate even if I had labeled data. Okay, it's a very simple proof. I'm going to even write it on the board. Okay. So. Yes.
No, it's okay. No. I am adaptive.
You're being videotaped, yes? So ask tough questions, you know. Fi is, what is it? It's the optimal g plus hi. And let's compute what is Cij. Cij was the average of fi of x, fj of x, over x. Let's plug in f is g plus hi, g plus hj. So we have the average of g times g. That's this quantity, let's call it g2. g2 is the average of g of x squared. Then I have g times hj. Let's call this aj. So aj is the average of hj times g. And then I have plus ai. And then I have the mixed term hi hj, which I assumed it was zero. Great. So this quantity I know. this quantity I assume for many that I know. So I have many linear equations in these quantities. So I just solve them. I get A's, and then each row J is just G2 plus AJ. And since I know these are two L's that scale like 1 over square root of N, I know these are two L's that scale like 1 over square root of N. If I have, so I need at least 3 regressors to have enough linear equations. If I have 5, 6 regressors, this is a linear system which is very well conditioned, very stable to invert. That's it. That was the sketch. So you should have shouted because I assumed that G2 it was known. G2 would be what's the best, your most accurate predictor of what's the variance of I minus G2 is the optimal mean squared error of prediction. You would very seldomly know such a quantity. And it would rarely be known. In addition, I can't really find it from this set of equations because everything is additive in G2. Like if I guess a value of G2, it just shifts my row additively. So in other words, what I'm telling you is that from that linear system of equations, I get a one-dimensional manifold or a set of solutions for rho and therefore for W, etc. So I need to somehow find what is the value of G2. And for that, I'm going to use this assumption that the experts are fairly close to the optimal one. Okay? That's where I need this assumption. So
you want us to shout if the assumptions are not realistic. So there is another problem.
Right? Okay.
Uncorrelated experts are in some way like embedded features. You're actually leveraging the fact that they're uncorrelated. But when you mentioned all the examples before, you mentioned rightly there are some bad experts and experts.
Yeah, so we're now doing the vanilla, the very clean case. And in practice, we're going to have to do many other things that I'm not sure I'm going to have time to mention all of them, but I'll show you some results on some of the data sets that I discussed. I'm still here, I didn't make a lot of money after the stock market. Okay, let's just calibrate the expectations, okay? Alright. Okay, so here I'm going to assume that the regressors are fairly close to the optimal G. Okay? So, it would be just convenient to introduce some epsilon parameter here and look what happens when epsilon tends to zero. Okay? So my claim is that when epsilon tends to zero, the following things happen. First, the leading eigenvalue of the matrix C has this form, and the leading eigenvector has this form. And essentially, the matrix C is approximately rank 2, again, right here. Okay? It's almost rank 1 and approximately.